Hi guys, it's Sophie. So, we're into August already. We're in a chill vibe. I've just had a shower, I've just done my skincare, I have a little, what's it called? Spot patch on. So it's just gonna be a chill one. I've just finished work, it's Monday. We had a really busy weekend, so I didn't get a chance to film at the weekend, so I'm gonna do a quickfire one after work. I have a lot of books, so we'll see how quickfire it is. What I thought is, I start with my little fiction pile. Oh, Foster's come. Because I read mostly non-fiction again in July and I'm really enjoying it. So let's go through the fiction I read. I started with Open Water by Caleb Azima Nelson. And I waited for this book forever and it turned out I'd ordered the wrong version. Because for some reason in Waterstones it said it was in stock. Like, it still said it was in stock when we went back on, but she helped me, we got the right one. And this is a tiny little book. I don't know why it took me as long as it did to get around to it, like, even before the Waterstones issue. It's just a very tight little love story about this couple who, both black, both living in London, both creative people who are like, I would say they're kind of glancing off each other and glancing off of this potential romantic connection that they have without seeming to kind of lay into one another, like connect with one another and stay connected for long enough for it to be what it needs to be. I did really like it. I can understand why so many people have liked it. And if you haven't read it, it's so short. I think I read it in like 2 hours probably. So that was the first one. The next one I didn't get on with, that was The Rapture by Claire McGlasson. For some reason I'd had it in my head that this was more close to contemporary than it was, and I think maybe that detracted from it a bit. I picked this one up because I know Simon loved it, so I'm sorry Simon. But we are looking at a community of women who believe that their leader is the female coming of Christ. It's in Bedford, it's this little cult, it's all based on a true story. I just didn't really connect with it, and I probably would have DNF'd it if I hadn't have read like as much of it as I had, and the fact it read fast, so I just didn't like this one, so yeah, not for me. The next one I read was Infinite Country by Patricia Engel. My book's all falling off because I was planning on putting them on my lap and Foster's put herself in my lap. This one is a family's experience of migration, is probably how I would describe it. It is a story that looks at a family split by migration and the rules around that and how family needs to grow around like the boundaries of the world that we're in and how that can break and shape families in very different ways. I did find it a little bit confusing partway through the book because I wasn't sure who we were following at the very beginning. I didn't quite understand what had happened and which of the children we were following. But once I got into it, I could understand it a lot more. It hasn't stuck with me that well though, would be what I would say. And I think it's got fairly mixed reviews. I think when I looked up on Goodreads after I bought it, it had like a kind of 3, so like good, but not like outstandingly good. So that was Infinite Country. The next one I did like, it's a quick little thrillery mystery type one. It is People Like Them. We look at two couples, two families really, who live close by one another in, I'm trying to see where it gives us the location, it's called Carmack, and this is again based on a true story. Did I say that already? Yeah, I did about the other one. This is based on a true story, and we find out right at the very beginning of the book, like I think it's the first or second chapter, no, it's the first chapter, so no spoilers, that one of the families has been brutally killed. And throughout the book we explore the motives of why this is and this little insular, like almost like picture perfect community that these families lived in. It's very quick, it's translated from the French. I would say if you like Lullaby by Lila Samani, you might enjoy this one too. Next one is probably going to win my weirdest book of the year that I've read. It's Come Join Our Disease by Sam Byers. We follow a woman who, when we meet her, is homeless. She's living on the streets and is kind of scraping by. She is mysteriously picked up by this sort of wellness corporation who promise her that they will be able to change her, make her into kind of this ideal citizen, show that anyone can glow up with the help of social media. But this goes into some pretty strange territory. What I would say is that if you are squeamish, particularly about bodies and waist, I wouldn't read this one. There's a lot of conversation here about feces, eating feces, wearing dead animals, like, that were alive when you had them. Lots of vomiting, and I don't do well with reading about vomiting. I had to stop a few times, but it's definitely a gross out book. I kind of understood what was going on and what it was for and the kind of points it was trying to make about the containment that's required to provide this kind of picture perfect self on, and the cleanliness of apps like YouTube or Instagram. But it was still a really weird read, and like, I found it quite physically uncomfortable. I think I would say I enjoyed the beginning and I also enjoyed the end, but the section in the middle, there was this really long section that was a little bit stomach churning, with the detail and the activities that they were undertaking that I kind of described. So yeah, I'm not really sure what I think of this one. It's not one I would be recommending. But if the topic and the ideas that's explored are intriguing enough for you to read a lot about vomit and a lot about poo, then maybe you'll like it. I don't know if that's helpful. It wasn't what I expected, I'll definitely say that. Then my last fiction book of the month was Still Missing by Beth Guccione. First Persephone that I read, and I really liked this. I read this when I was in a not very good mood. I posted on Instagram that I was just having a bit of a struggling day. But once I'd kind of like gotten out of my own head, I really liked this book. In like very brief, and like there's not a lot of spoilers to give really with this one, but it's about a woman whose son has gone missing. He's 6 years old, 5 or 6 years old. He was walking to school just round the corner, and the mother waves him away down to go to school, and he turns the corner and then is not seen again. And we follow the police investigation, the ins and outs of the parent, everyone else who is involved, all the characters in their life around the disappearance of this boy. I really enjoyed it. It actually made me cry a little bit. I don't know if it was because I was in a vulnerable place, but the like story did make me cry at points, and I really enjoyed it. So it's maybe cured me of my little bit of a fear of Persephone books, which is good. Then I have a lot of non-fiction. I do have one poetry book. I'm going to try and squeeze it out and see. The thing it's leaning on isn't particularly, it's not particularly well balanced. But yeah, I've managed to pull out the poetry, then the rest is just non-fiction. This is the Antrobus Perseverance. No. This is the Perseverance by Raymond Antrobus. It's just the way it's formatted. I thought that. I was like, that's a surname. Did I miss a line in the title? And this is a little, tiny little collection of poetry about the deaf experience, deaf as a cultural identifier rather than as like a descriptor. And it really is just little snippets of deafness and what that means. It has some sign language within it. I think it's British Sign Language mostly throughout it, but it does have little signs. I know very little British Sign Language. When I was a child, I learned the alphabet, and I learned a few like descriptive words like girl, boy, mum, dad, sister, brother, because I had a friend whose mum looked after and worked with some deaf children. But that's all I know of British Sign Language, and I don't know anyone who identifies as culturally deaf, though I do know several people who do identify as hard of hearing. And I just found this one really interesting. It kind of made me want to learn more sign language. Like, this is probably going to sound really bad, but I always thought I'd get one okay in an emergency if I really had to, because at least I could spell. But I'd really like to be able to have the ability to learn a bit more, and I actually did. I'm not very good with languages, but because there's not really a grammatical structure as such in sign language, that was the bit I always found hard. So I found this one really inspiring, and it is, obviously because it's poetry, very short. Yeah, I really, really liked it. I'd be interested in reading anything else that is about culturally deaf people, because that, even as a concept, is something that's very new to me. within the last sort of like 3-4 months. So I'm really interested to understand more about that and learn a bit more, but I would definitely recommend the perseverance. The next one is one I spoke about in my medical nonfiction video. This is Care Work by Leah Lakshima Pipanitsa Samarasena. And this book is talking about disability through a lens of race and queerness. It is advocating for a different way of thinking about what we offer as care, moving away from a sort of paid care model to a community care model. I found that this book was probably too high of a level in terms of the political aspects of disability, which is something I am not familiar with at all, but there was a lot of terminology I was kind of gleaning from this book and a lot of understanding I was beginning to work my way into, but I feel like I've missed like a middle ground between some of the other types of books I have on this list and this book. Like, I'm missing some steps, and I'm very aware that I am like very new and naive to this. So if you have books that would help me like learn more about disability like as a political thing, I'd be really interested to know what it is that you think is worth reading that's that kind of introductory level, because I think this was a step above. So whilst I did enjoy it and I could like read it and understand it, I felt like I was missing something. So yeah, that's Care Work. It was very interesting, and I would say I probably agree with like a mixed model of like community care and state funded care, because as it's kind of spoken about in this book, the community funded care is reliant on people having that community, and I worry about the people who wouldn't. And I, when I'm reading this, I'm also thinking about mental health, and I think a lot about how people I've known who've had severe mental illness lack any of that community, like even one person to go home to when they come home from hospital, particularly people with schizophrenia. But yeah, really interesting, had me thinking clearly, but I'll be interested in any recommendations for more kind of introductory texts. The next one is Know My Name by Chanel Miller. And I'm gonna find it really hard to review this like properly, because I think this is probably the most triggering book I've ever read. I am a survivor of sexual assault. Some of you guys probably know that if you've watched my old videos. If you're newer here, you probably have no idea, because it's not something I talk about very often. But I really struggled engaging with the content of this book, because I actually got a little bit like unwell a few nights because of it, and had my first proper flashback in a really long time. So I don't think it's particularly that this book is really triggering. I think it just hit some things for me personally, not even because the content was similar, but some of the emotions and the way the story was told in a way that hasn't hit me in a while. So I would say tread with caution as always, in that there's plenty of trigger warnings here. So with the kind of trigger warning section out of the way, this is the story of the woman who was left for dead in the Brock Turner case. She is talking about how she as a person was damaged and broken, obviously, by the events, but then also politicised and depersonalised through the media and idealised by survivors and everyone around her, and just talking about this whole experience of being a victim and an advocate and a poster child for lots of other people all the way across the world. And it was so well written and affecting that I really would just recommend you pick it up if you feel able. But as I say, I found this intensely challenging to read. I think it's a very vulnerable book that talks a lot about the emotionality of what's happening, and perhaps that's why it hit home more so. I think whilst I have read a lot of books by survivors, probably that defensive factual facade can come down more, and this didn't, and it hit me very hard. But if you have never experienced that and aren't worried about triggers, please do read it. And if you do find yourself having triggers, I still think it's probably worth trying, but just be gentle with yourself around it. The next one I read was It's Just Nerves by Kelly Davio. And she has something called, I think it's called myasthenia gravis. I think that's how you say it. I'll see if I can, if that's not right, I apologise, it's just because it's medical terminology that I'm probably not as good with it. And it is a collection of essays around her disability, how it interacts with her life and her sense of self, The illness is something that is progressive, and I think I hadn't read a story where it was necessarily sort of bound to be progressive, and that was a kind of new experience. But because it's written in essays, it's also, I think, fairly accessible to pick up and read through. But it was something that I didn't even know the condition existed. I'd never heard of it before. But I mean, she's talking about all kinds of things, down from like housing to elections, to like portrayals of people with disability in film, all kinds of things, or her particular diagnoses being, I think it was Empire, I think that's the TV show, being represented in that show, and how they just like lionized all of the elements of it that made the good show and just removed anything that didn't make sense for their character development. Yeah, I enjoyed this one. I don't think it was one of my absolute favourites, but I do think it was a really interesting little book, and it definitely helped me get my head into like progressive illness a little bit more. The next one I have is Everybody by Olivia Lang. This one is looking at the politics of bodies, from being unwell to being queer to being a prisoner, all sorts of things. Being sex workers, I think, is also in this. And it's looking at the politics of existing in the world as a physical person, thing, person and thing, and the way that we interact with those aspects of ourselves. I did feel like it was trying to do quite a lot, would be what I would say, and I almost felt like I couldn't get as deep into any of them as I'd have wanted to. I would have preferred, admittedly, it's probably too much work and not for Olivia Lang to do, but a whole non-fiction book on each of those topics. However, I did think it was interesting as a concept to be thinking about the different ways in which lots of bodies are politicised, especially in conjunction with a lot of the books I'm reading about unwellness. In terms of writing, it's Olivia Lang, so if you have read her before, it's a similar writing style to other things that you might have read by her. And for those that are not normally non-fiction readers, you might like the fact that this covers quite a lot of topics without having to commit yourself to one whole long book about something if you're more interested in the concept. I enjoyed it. It isn't my favourite one of hers that I've read though. Then I picked up Do No Harm by Harry Marsh, which was probably the most recommended book from a medical non-fiction video. This is case studies of a neurosurgeon, and he goes through lots of different illness types, lots of different experiences with patients. I think most of them are illness types though, from memory. I think the vast majority are. Yeah, they are. And we talk about the way that he is undertaking his practice. I did enjoy it. But I do feel like I've read quite a lot of it, quite a lot of stuff like this. I think it was a really good story. It's just that kind of like, if you're into like medical nonfiction that's like case explorations, I think you'll really like it. But I also feel like it felt quite similar to a lot of other stuff. Not to say I didn't like it. So thank you for everyone who did recommend it. I had a really nice Saturday afternoon and Sunday reading it. But I think I've oversaturated myself with it a little bit. Another book on bodies. This one I enjoyed a little bit less. I think this was potentially a little bit dated and that did it in. I'm not sure when it was published. Let's see. Published in 2009. Now I think that is quite dated for the conversation we're having about bodies. Things like discussion of trans bodies was so behind where we are now. Things like plastic surgery, the reasons behind that, the kind of Instagram world or social media world. I almost wanted this book but updated, I think, was probably the problem. I do enjoy reading a lot of contemporary fiction and contemporary non-fiction, and I was interested to read this one, but enough times, you know, that's how many years? 11 years old? That's a fair amount of difference for us to be examining bodies in that way. I mean, they are talking about, there's, you know, separate elements around it, but really I would say it's her moving us, wanting to move us towards a concept of a body being a thing that carries your mind rather than the body as kind of the full product. And she's coming at this from a kind of psychotherapy background and seeing people struggle with eating disorders or body perception, but it just felt a little retro. So yeah, kind of reader beware. You might find you like some of it, but some of the ideas you're just like, oh, we're still doing that? And I'm like, oh no, we were, this is probably representative of what general understanding or like the community's view was at the time, but it does feel a little old fashioned, so that's that one. I did though read another Susie Orbeck in the same month, which is In Therapy. This book is a fictionalized set of therapy sessions with a number of different people, so some single people and some couples. They were actors who undertook this for a Radio 4, I think. Yeah, a Radio 4 series about what happens within therapy. So the actors were given the scenarios rather than everything being precisely scripted, and they worked through the problems with their script. Sorry, they worked through the problems like without the full script to try and make it feel a little bit more natural. I found it quite interesting to learn about what is going on in the mind of the therapist when they're providing therapy and the kind of things they're aware of in their own emotional position with the client. And I enjoyed this more than Bodies, I would say. I think if you're going to read one of the two, I would recommend In Therapy. The next book I read was fascinating and I recommend everyone read it. It is Dear Centurion by Awake Mezi. This is her memoir talking about herself, and I'm probably going to mess up some of the terminology because this is completely new. I'd never heard of this before her or before them. I think it's before them. Yeah, before them. But they identify as a split sort of human god spirit, essentially. I was trying to explain it to Tom. It's a fairly complicated idea. So originally they understood that they were part of this sort of spirit that was part of their body. People were born and understood to be almost like spirits trapped within human bodies. But over time, as they were developing their identity, they identified as sort of small god is how they put it, within a person. And they're talking about the kind of differences and similarities to the trans experience and the difficulties that they experience of their spiritual confusion and their thoughts about their bodies, but how their body is not really a true representation of the spirit and the spirituality that is the core of their discomfort. It's a really interesting book and I found it quite challenging to read through because it's so unfamiliar to me, this type of spiritual gender-ish thing. It's just gorgeous writing. I underlined quite a lot of it. It's also, whilst it's not about mental illness, there's a lot in here that is in respect of challenging mental health scenarios. I think they call it body dysphoria. No, spirit, they call it something like spiritual dysphoria within this and the impact that can have on them. And I could relate to some of those elements within there. The other aspect that they talk about within this book that I found fascinating was the autonomy to change your body for whatever reason that you might choose. There's a lot in here, I'm thinking about it a lot, and I'm sorry, I know that I've messed up pronouns a few times in those. I've tried to just remind myself when I get to them. I think I find it challenging partly because I'm not that familiar with using they, them in my life, but also because I'm trying to be respectful to the fact that they use they, them pronouns, but they also don't identify as non-binary, so my brain is like fighting with itself, so apologies for everyone, I'm trying my best. The next one I read is one I've heard a lot of people really enjoy, but I enjoyed less than I've enjoyed some other collections of this type, which is Growing Up Disabled in Australia. It is a collection of lots of essays, poetry. I don't think there's like fictional stories, quite a lot of poetry, more poetry than I'd expected, talking about the way in which disabled people have kind of built their life. And also it was really interesting to hear like elder disabled people talking about the ways in which attitudes have changed or access have changed over time. And it's definitely kind of a collective identity for lots of different people within this, so you kind of have a commonality and common thread through this. However, I still think I prefer disability visibility over this, and I think probably that meant I didn't enjoy this one as much as I had. The other aspect that I have to kind of say is because whilst I have a disability in terms of my mental health, I'm not physically disabled, so I am potentially not kind of resonating with these as much as I would if this was a whole collection on mental illness. So probably going more on what I perceive of the quality of the writing, and I think Disability Visibility was a slightly better book. But I can, you know, it's not my community, so take that into account. Then I have Aftermath by Rachel Cusk. This book is talking about her divorce, the way that this affected her, the way that she managed her feelings around the divorce, and it's just written so beautifully. Like, I sat in this chair, this is in Tom's office, which is why I never film here, because he's normally playing games in the corner. But I sat here and I read an awful lot, and we were both just like, damn, she can write. I maybe prefer this to some of her fiction. I feel like potentially there's more distance in her fiction than there was in this piece, and I want to see more of that in her fiction. I don't know if other people feel that, but it added to my experience of having read some of her fiction. But I also felt, I was like, why don't we do this more at certain points? I think it's interesting because one of the things she talks about in this book is about her positioning of femininity and masculinity and how she perceives herself as a more masculine woman and has taken on the traits of masculinity, and the vulnerability in this book and the lack of it that I kind of perceive, though I've not reread any of her fiction, made me feel like maybe her work is an expression of those more masculine elements and there's less vulnerability in it. But it was interesting nevertheless. I very much enjoy this little piece and I hope to never get divorced, it sounds terrible. But it was something I could reflect on, having seen my parents get divorced, of that identity making as a single part rather than part of a couple. Then I read The Fifth Risk by Michael Lewis. I had read Pandemic by him and enjoyed that. I enjoyed this one less, I have to say. I will give him another try, but it might be that I really like one, but on the whole he's not someone for me. This was about the innermost workings of the US government. It felt parts of it were really interesting, and there's parts of it that I remember that I was like, that's a cool story. But a lot of it wasn't interesting enough, potentially because I'm not a citizen of the US, so I didn't have like personal involvement in the services that were being talked about. I don't know, because I normally don't mind that. But yeah, I felt like some of it was almost too governmental, too bureaucratical for me to get the interest behind it. But I'm going to give him one more go. I'm going to give it one more go. It's just talking about the Trump presidency and the risks that are inherent in unplanned leadership decisions and the removal of kind of the middle management structure that remains continuous through different electoral, you know, roles in the States. Yeah, maybe it was just a little too niche for me, but I will give Michael Lewis one more go. Then I read Golem Girl by River Lyra, I think. This is one of my favourite like memoirs, I think. This is one of my new favourite memoirs. She has spina bifida, and she also is a painter. She is just talking about her life. It's a memoir, so she's just talking about her life. But the style of writing and the skill of what she had about writing about her own experience throughout her life and drawing a picture of what that life looked like in a movement from a disabled childhood that was focused around medical intervention to provide the closest to a cure or normalcy that her parents could kind of find for her to the acceptance of herself and moving towards advocacy in disabled spaces was just fascinating. But the writing was gorgeous. And like, sometimes I read books and I know the book itself is of value, but I can also, a bit like The Fifth Risk, I can tell the book is saying some interesting things, but I've not been pulled along that much. It's more of a chore to read, whereas this was a pleasure to read throughout. If you haven't read this one but you're interested, please do. It really was probably top memoir I've read this year. I think it's going to stay on one of my top memoirs of all time. Then the final book I have is American Baby, A Mother, A Child and the Shadow, History of Adoption by Gabrielle Glasser. This I had expected to be a story of multiple adoptions, but it is not. It is a single story told as biography, essentially, of a mother and her child. The book and this story is a sort of example of the type of adopted practice that took place across the US when the baby boom was taking place. So the kind of cultural aspects of moving towards fertility, fecundity, hundreds of children, mixed with the very rigid expectations about no sex before marriage and before abortions were legal, led to this scenario not dissimilar to what we kind of understand about Ireland, where young women who became pregnant had their children forcibly removed and adopted by couples who often spent money to kind of acquire those children, which the money never reached the mothers. And we talk through this story, but we also look about the legacy of sort of that adoptive trauma in not having a root or a past, and the obvious trauma for the mother also. I did like this one. I was just a little disappointed because for some reason going in I thought it was going to be less of a kind of biographical book and more of a lots of facts about why it worked, how it worked that way and why it changed. But that's not to say I didn't enjoy it, I maybe just anticipated something else. So that's everything I've read in the month of July. Lots and lots of non-fiction. We're gonna have lots of non-fiction again, I think, in August. I really want to even out my split to 50-50, and I'm also just really enjoying reading it at the minute. I go through phases where one draws me more than the other, and I expect when I get to like November time and I'm like full to my gills of non-fiction, I'll read fiction and I'll remember, oh my goodness, there's stories, oh my goodness, this book reads fast, because that's the thing you forget, fiction reads a lot faster, and I'll remember how beautiful things can be written, because whilst obviously some books in here are beautifully written, it's maybe a little bit artsier, the fiction side of things. But hopefully you guys have enjoyed hearing me chat about some of these books, and I'll see you guys again soon in my next video. I have this weekend off, I haven't got any tasks to do this weekend or any events on this weekend, so I'm hoping I might get a little bit of pre-filming done for you all, so the next weekend, which is insane, I might manage to have a video up for you all. See you again soon, and look after yourselves until then. Bye!